Shalom, good evening everyone. I'm glad to be back. In the last two weeks I was in Eretz Israel, and Baruch Hashem had lectures all over. And the thing that made me the happiest is when I spoke in two American yeshivot in Yerushalayim, in Jerusalem, one Lev Aaron in Har Nof, and one Or Sameach in Shmuel HaNavi there in Yerushalayim. And Baruch Hashem, you know, Chazal said that one image, one view, it's better than many, many conversations. You can talk and people explain to you, but when you see in your own eyes, then you get the right picture. So I hear all the time, I get emails, I hear from people that became Balei Tshuva from the lectures here in America, when they went to yeshivot in Eretz Israel. But the shock that I got, that when I went to the yeshivot there, I saw basically almost every one of the faces is people from the lectures. I recognize all of them, almost all of them. And plus the other one I didn't recognize, they also came and say, we listened to the shiurim and we got here in the yeshiva. They're in Eretz Israel, you don't even know. So it makes me very happy, that's number one. And it also should make all the supporters very happy. The people who sponsor all the CDs in the last few years, even though unfortunately it's going down now instead of going up. And I have some trips coming up and I don't have money for the CDs to take with me enough CDs. But what can I do? But in general, the people who supported all this should be very happy. Why? Because even if your entire effort made one Baal Tshuva, it was already a great thing for you. Needless to say, tens, needless to say, hundreds. So all these people who Baruch Hashem became, like one of the Bachurim there, maybe 24 years old, before I left, he came to me and he said to me, you know, I was mamash nothing. I started to listen to the CDs, now he had peot, beard. You should see how he became there in yeshiva. Like serious people, Baruch Hashem. So we have results for our efforts, Baruch Hashem. It's a lot of work. However, there's also many people who have no direction. They become religious, but they don't have a follow-up. They don't have a community. They're not finding themselves a place where they're going to belong to. Then a person needs a synagogue. He needs a local rabbi. You cannot have a verbal rabbi that you can all your life be in touch with him through emails. You still need somebody local who knows you. Tomorrow you need to get married. Tomorrow you have something to do. Chas v'shalom, it could be a brit milah. It could be chas v'shalom, could be a funeral. It can be things like this. You need somebody local. Some of these people, they're becoming religious, but it's all through the lecture, through the internet, but they don't really have a personal rabbi. A person needs to have a personal rabbi, and if he doesn't have in his area, he has to move out of this area. Many of the questions I get, there's no shul next to where I live. So the answer to all these people who ask this question, first thing a Jew has to do before he chooses a place to live, he has to check the synagogues in the area. He has to check the synagogues, he has to check the yeshivot for his children, before he chooses a house, not like some fools do. First buy a house and then they hope that they're going to have good education for their children. And this is even by the goyim. It's not only by Jews. A goy that wants to buy a fancy mansion or a house. What good is that if there's no schools for your children there? Or you're not happy with the school? First you have to choose the good schools. After you have good schools, then you decide if you want to buy the place or no. So you have to check for synagogue, community, that you feel belongs to that community, that you won't just live in a nice house and you feel like you're in a desert spiritually. So this is you know. So anyway, so Baruch Hashem, you see results for all these things, but it's not enough. I always say we can get to so many Jews out there. Nobody reached them. On the other hand, there are people who go down because they don't have a community, or people who even grew up religious all their life. Then eventually they get to a certain age, they go down. Plus, there are very wicked people over the internet that they take advantage on people's ignorance. And they pretend that they know a lot, and they fool a lot of people who don't understand. And they manipulate, they lie, they change, they create mistakes in the Torah, create mistakes in the Tanakh, writing all kinds of things, critics, and people who anyway are weak spiritually, anyway they're weak. And it's the Torah is a real burden for them. It's heavy on their shoulder. They are dying to get rid of it. They are dying to get rid of the efforts of getting up in the morning, of praying, of eating only kosher, or not making sins, or not stealing, or keeping Shabbos, and leave work early. It's already a burden for them because they're not connected to Hashem. When you're not connected to Hashem, every little thing, even to wash your hands, is a burden. Believe me, and I see it all the time. Oh, to get up now to wash my hands before he eats bread? No, you know, let me find mezonot bread. Oh, maybe 2 minutes, I'm going to have to make a bracha. 2 minutes, I'm going to, no, it's too much. Okay, find me something that it's easier. It gets to a point that a person doesn't even want to do the minimum of the minimum. Why? He's not connected to Hashem. You're not connected to Hashem, you're like a robot. And someone tell you, go like this. If there's no meaning in what you do, you don't feel why you want to do it. All these kind of people who anyway are not connected to Hashem, first opportunity to have to find a critic that supposedly make it logical in their eyes. Oh, you know what? Maybe I'm wasting my time in religion. Right away, they run out. Oh, you know why I'm like that? Okay, yeah, someone proved to me that it's not right. So get it through your head. There's no mistakes in the Torah. Nothing whatsoever. The Torah is divine. And if you ever have these doubts, just watch Torah and science again. When you watch Torah and science, you get the point. Everything I show there in a film, no one can write. Only the creator of the world. So anyway, now, as you know, there are still many places in New York that don't have power. There's no gas to get in most places. There's people waiting all night in gas stations to still get a tank of gas. And people fighting and police in every gas station to make orders. If you remember, a year ago I spoke about what can happen here in a big city of New York, the capital of the world. Wall Street, who would believe they shut the stock market for 2 days straight, something that never happened in history, perhaps. You know how many billions of dollars lost every day, every minute that the stock market is closed? There's no way to count how much money. The disaster of this hurricane, first of all, everybody understands the biggest disaster in America's history, perhaps, or in New York's history, I should say. But it's not only that, it's going to be altogether about $100 billion damage. Because the 30 or 40 billion that it's physical damage, besides that it's potential damage, which means how much we should have made, how much hours of work were lost, how many transactions were lost, all together tax money for the government of those. If you take 20 million New Yorkers and plus the other cities, so it's about 100 million Americans that don't work for a week, and take the taxes alone, that can be who knows how many billion. Just the taxes alone. Now people don't go to stores, so every state loses 8-9% sales tax on billions of transactions. That adds up, it can add maybe to $200 billion damage. As it is already, this country is dying financially. They print billions of dollars every day. The machines don't stop. In Elo Yanum Velo Yishan Shomer Israel. The Pasuk says, Hashem is never rest. He never sleeps. He always supervises. He always watches us. In America, you can add one more thing. And the dollar machines, they never rest. Maybe they added more buildings. Maybe they bring more machines. I don't know. They print nonstop. Like more than they print tissues, they print dollars. And it's still not helping. 2-3 years by now, the machines are printing and printing billions and billions and billions. Imagine how much the economy lost before all this printing. What would happen if they wouldn't print all these hundreds of billions of dollars? People would already kill each other on the street a long, long time ago. That's already preventing a catastrophe. But HaKadosh Baruch Hu has his own plan. Nothing can help. You can print as much as you want. Print. $100 billion damage in 20 minutes. No, again. The next one, who knows what's going to be. So this is a reminder. They all say nature. Everyone runs away from the main thing. There's no nature, there's no nothing. There's a boss to the world. The boss is angry, He wanted to teach people a lesson, to wake us up, Jews, non-Jews, everyone to wake up. And many people ask me, what do you think is the cause of the disaster of the hurricane? It can be hundreds of things. It doesn't have to be one thing. If you want to ask my opinion, my guess is that in New York they decided to make gay marriage, to make it legal. These are the things that makes God the angriest. When he made nature, and he made male and female, and he made a marriage, and he made a system, and even by the animals is like this, and people with free choice decide that they're going to redesign the world. You interfere with my creation, you have no right to exist. That's what people have to understand. People always made that sin. It didn't start in this generation. Men with men, and women with women, and people with animals. All these things existed in the time of the Torah. If it didn't exist, the Torah wouldn't give all these warnings and all these execution punishments. If the Torah spoke about this thing 3,300 years in a generation that people were a million times holier than today, so it's needless to say that today these things exist. But there's one thing that a person does it in hidden room and is embarrassed of what he does, there's one thing. When a person walks in the street and he wants to make it legal and we are normal, you are not normal. You and your wife are not normal. Me and my husband are normal. Yes, the world will have no right to remain. That's what happened here. They want to make in this country, the more they're going to make rules like Sodom and Gomorrah here, our end here will be exactly like Sodom and Gomorrah. You remember what happened to them? The five cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, Hashem burned them from atomic bomb that fell from heaven on their heads. And all the millions of wicked people were vanished. And this is the parasha that Avraham Avinu begged Hashem, maybe you're going to find 50 righteous people there. And Hashem say, yes, maybe if we find 50 people over there, I agree. And maybe 45. Okay, so we couldn't find 50. Avraham, the righteous person, the righteous Hebrew person, is trying to defend the five cities of wicked people. And he's negotiating with the creator of the world. First of all, it's very interesting because we can learn a lot about the way God thinks. It can help us to choose the right path in life. First of all, you see the way of one individual compared to millions. Even though the world didn't have 7 billion people in the time of Avraham Avinu, if they had, tens of millions, or there's no indication exactly how many people lived in that time. We're talking 3,600 years ago. It could be maybe half a billion, maybe a billion. We don't really know, but it doesn't matter. It was a huge amount of people. And there's one righteous person only. Why his name is Hebrew? Why the Torah call him Avraham HaIvri? Abraham the Hebrew. What Hebrew means? Hebrew means one-sided. Me'ever echad shel ha'olam is in one side of the world. And all the wicked people on the other side of the world. One righteous person, millions, hundreds of millions of wicked people that God cannot stand them. And he has a plan to destroy all of them. And what happened? The righteous person that the wicked people hate so much, because wicked people always hate righteous people, always. Why? Because there's a pin in the neck. He always shows us how wrong we are, even if he doesn't make a beep. Just the wicked people, as soon as they see a religious man, the more religious he is, the more they hate him. That's how it is. Even nice people, even that they're nice, usually nice people, as soon as they see a religious person, they're not always showing it, but inside their heart, they're not feeling comfortable around him. They're hoping, when would he go, this person? He doesn't belong here. Why is it? Because when he lives according to his belief and faith, everything he does makes me feel uncomfortable. Why? Because I don't live according to the rules. He lives according to the rules in my neighborhood. It makes me feel guilty feelings, conscious feelings. I suffer. That's why the wicked people always fight in Israel and the rest of the world when they want to make a synagogue in the neighborhood. They fight, they go to court, they make demonstration, they even become violent. Every place in Israel, in a building, you have 20 flight buildings, one religious man moved to the building, everyone gathered together, meetings, how do we stop him? Now we're not talking Nazi Germany. We're not talking in the Arab countries when almost everyone is anti-Semite, cannot stand Jews. We're talking in our own country, in Tel Aviv, in places like this. One person move, black hat, beard, oh, it's already a pin in the neck. He's going to tell us what to wear. We're not going to feel comfortable walking naked around him. You know, his children's maybe going to brainwash our children. That's how they think. No rabbi is allowed to give a lecture in the Israeli army. No one would let him. A priest, yeah. Democracy, freedom of speech. The Arab, the head of the Hamas, he wants to speak. Of course, we'll give him a stage. Wow, it's a democracy. A local rabbi wants to give a lecture in the army? Never. They'll never let you speak. Not only that, if they know that you're listening to him, they'll do everything they can to stop you. God forbid the soldiers will become religious, it will be the end of our army. That's how they think. So this is what's happening. So Avraham Avinu, the one that everyone hates, what does he do? Instead of say, ishtabach shemo, no, when will I get rid of all these wicked people that are choking me all over? Let's get rid of them. Why? The Torah says, be'avod reshaim rina. When the wicked people are destroyed, it's a party. It's a celebration. But what? It's such a good person, Avraham Avinu. I don't even know if he did the right thing or not. I'll tell you the truth. Only Hashem knows if it was good what he did or not. But I'm telling you what the Torah says. We cannot argue with what the Torah says. He's going to fight for all these wicked people that Hashem will keep them in the world. What for? I don't know. You ask me, I don't know why he needs them in the world. Who needs all these people? All these murderers, all these thieves, all these people who does crimes against God day and night. Why Abraham is fighting for them and begging for Hashem to keep them alive? So first of all, really, if you look at the argument, Abraham wasn't really fighting for the wicked people. He was fighting for the righteous people. He said, maybe there are righteous people over there. You're going to kill the righteous people with the wicked people. But really, his intention was to try to save everyone. Well, he was making it as an excuse. Now you're going to destroy the entire city. You drop an atomic bomb from heaven. Millions of people will die. Among them will be righteous people. The atomic bomb doesn't recognize who is righteous and who is not. If it falls, it kills everyone. So first of all, the Gemara says that you should know there's a rule. Even though usually everything Hashem does is 100% justice, nobody gets a scratch unless he deserves it. But there is a situation that when the destruction comes to a place, it affects everyone, even the righteous people who live there. Everyone. Why is it? The Gemara says, Oy la rasha and oy le shcheno. Oy means how bad for the wicked person, and how bad for his neighbor, which means, why do you want to be a neighbor of such a wicked person? Why do you even want to live with him? Why are you not running away from him like you run away from fire? Which means, the Torah already tells us that the righteous people should not want to live among the wicked people. Because the wicked people will always win. They always win because the Yetzer Hara, the evil inclination, and the Satan is helping them. Satan is interested that the righteous people will become wicked. He wants the righteous people to start dressed naked. He wants them to start cursed. He wants them to start do all kinds of things that they never did until now. So he does everything he can to help the wicked people, to overcome the righteous people. What's the question? It's very hard. You go, you live in a building, 300 wicked people, and you want to be righteous over there? Every morning you have to speak to them, you have to listen to their things. I've been now in Israel, I went to some places. I've seen things that I never believe I see. First of all, the streets full of garbage. Full of garbage. People put their garbages on the street. It's not like here. It's here, it's more organized. The truck comes, pick it up from your home. And now all you need is a little wind over there. And then the cats, it's full of cats over there. The Thailandi ate all the dogs. I guess they don't like cats so much. So it's plenty of cats. So as soon as you put your garbage, now you have a building, there's two lousy garbage cans. They put tons of bags, the whole name, nobody cares. They put on the floor, one on top of the other. The cats come at night, they make a party. The entire street is full of garbage. And they don't clean. We don't clean. It's not like here, you know, if somebody is, the streets will be full of garbage, they will get to the news. Over there, I don't know, maybe garbage likes to live in garbage. So much garbage, human garbage. So many people, so many horrible people, so many curses, so many lack of modesty, such things that people have no connection to Hashem, nothing in their life. You in the middle of the day, you come to you walk in a building, you hear people have intimate relation, they don't care, they don't close the window, the whole street listen to what they do. No morale, even animals behave better than some of the things I've seen in Israel. In Israel, in a place where the sin is much heavier than overseas. People ask me, should I move to Israel? Depends. If you know you are much better, you're doing much more mitzvot than sins, maybe it's good to move. But if not, better not to. Why? Every sin over here is much easier than there. Over there, it's inside the living room of the creator of the world, not in his backyard. You make the sin in his backyard, no. You do it inside his living room, inside his bedroom. The bedroom of the king, you enter right there inside, in front of him to do it, it's much worse. It's not me, it's the Gemara say. The sins in the Holy Land that contaminate the land that God loves. This is what the Torah says, Eretz asher enei Hashem Elokecha ba, mireshit ha-shana, acharit ha-shana. This is the land that the eyes of your God is in it from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. Do you have any other country in the world that the Torah says that the eyes of God is in it? The eyes of God is everywhere. In China, and in Japan, and in India, and in all the other places. The hand of God is everywhere. But the Torah didn't say the hand of God is in China. The head of God is in Japan. The head of God is in the United States or in Russia. Or on the moon or in all the other galaxies. That's not what the Torah says. The Torah said the eyes of God is in this little tiny land, the Holy Land. This is it. And if a person comes there and makes the sin, it's much, much worse. So you go over there, you see what's happening, you're wondering to yourself, very, very difficult. So when the disaster comes, it takes the righteous people with the wicked people together out of here. Why? Once the Satan gets permission to destroy, he doesn't tell the difference between righteous and wicked and destroy the whole place. So what's the solution? Live in a place with righteous people. Make sure you go to a place where the righteous people live. And if there is no, move out of that city. And if doesn't, you don't have it in the entire country, move out of this country. And if you're lazy, you don't want to move, it costs a lot to move, too bad. It's much more important than to destroy your soul. Yeah, it's convenient, we just bought a house, we like it here, it's nice, quiet, there's a good authorities here, security, it's all baloney. There is holiness in a place, spirituality, yes or no? If yes, no problem, very good. If no, you have no permission to live there one day. One day, you don't have permission to live there. You know, I've participated in seminars in the past that we used to invite holy people from Israel to pray in a seminar for the success that many secular people would become religious eventually by the end of the seminar. I've seen some of these rabbis, they didn't want to sleep on a bed of the hotel. They were sleeping on the floor. I asked them, why you sleep on the floor? They say, a bed like this, that so many sins were made on it, I'm going to put my body on it. Not to talk about going into the showers over there. This is the way a holy person think. A holy person care about his soul. He cares about what Hashem thinks about me. Not everything, yalla, no problem. Whatever happened, happened. You know what's the difference between a righteous and a wicked person? Even though the wicked never thinks he's wicked. You ask him if you're wicked, God forbid, I'm wicked, chas v'shalom. You know what's the difference between the righteous and the wicked people? The righteous person chooses his future. The wicked person lives by the moment. Whatever comes, comes. If good come, very good. If bad come, also very good. No problem. Someone invites him. Come for Shabbat. He doesn't think how it's going to be the shul there, the sleeping arrangements, what my children going to see, how kosher the food's going to be, what am I losing by leaving my shul and going to another place, what's going to be in that shul. I have a kosher shul right here. I can pray good. The prayers is excellent, holy. Who knows what's happening over there? He doesn't check. Whatever happened, happened. We'll find out when we get to Brooklyn. It happened to me once. I learned my lesson. I went to a synagogue First of all, as soon as I walked there, I realized right away it was the mistake of my life. People didn't stop talking. You come to pray, it looks like an old age club. Everyone sitting and talking, da-da-da-da-da. Then what happened is when they take out the Torah, the person is pointing, you know, is lifting the Torah to show the crowd. I all of a sudden hear someone gave a punch to another person. He fell all over the chairs. Mamash gangsters. What are they doing in the shul? I still don't understand. People like this should not have permission to enter the shul, bichlal, ever. Until they first become human being. The shul was made for human being who try to come and pray and be close to Hashem. If a cat or a dog wants to come into a synagogue and wants to be close to Hashem, synagogue, it's not the place. You want to be close to Hashem? Go on the trees. Do what you have to do over there. You want to be close to Hashem? First, you have to be a human being. Now, after you're a human being, you have permission to enter to the yeshiva. The Gemara say in their times, they didn't accept everyone who wanted to come to learn Torah. Today we're begging people, come, come, learn Torah. Don't worry, the Torah will make you a mensch, will make you a good person. But in the time of the Chachamim, the Gemara say, who was it? Rabban Gabliel, he made a decree that no one is allowed to enter the bet. He put a guard in the entrance of the yeshiva, and the guard had a list who got the certificate from the rabbi that is a kosher person and who doesn't. If you have a stamp, the rabbi approved that I'm a kosher person, you're allowed to come enter and learn Torah. You don't have that stamp, stay outside. What do you mean? I want to learn Torah. You tell me not to learn Torah? Yes, we don't want you here. We want only kosher people. First people we want. We don't want monkeys here. First you become a human being. Now after human being, we'll teach you Torah. Then later, when he retired, he finished his time. When he finished, what happened? The one who replaced him, Rabbi Elazar, everyone is allowed. So the yeshiva became packed. Up to then, it was half empty. Now it became packed with people. So the former president, he felt bad. Wow, maybe I made a mistake. Maybe I prevented Torah learning in the nation of Israel. He got very nervous. To prevent Torah learning? You know what a sin it is? The things that God loved the most, I am the reason that it stopped. How can I sleep at night ever again? But Hashem came to him in a dream and showed him a sign in a dream. You are right. I'm not looking for quantity. I'm looking for quality. We're not looking for quantity, only quality. Remember, 100 pages you learn, you don't understand anything, but you learn one page and you understand good, better for Hashem. It doesn't need you to be, oh, you know what, I finished the whole shas. Many times people come and tell me, oh, I'm making a siyum. What? I finished the masechet. I know if I ask him 5-10 questions on the masechet, he won't even know what I'm talking about. As long as he make a party, I finish a siyum. I never made one siyum in my whole life. I finished Gemarot. I don't have the guts to make a siyum. I say, when I come in front of Hashem, he's going to tell me, hey, you made a siyum, let's test you on the masechet. I don't know where to hide. Better not to pretend I know any masechet. Siyum, not one siyum I had in my whole life. Siyum, I finished, yeah, but I know, I finished, I didn't even start. I finish again, I didn't even start. I finish again, I still didn't even start. The opposite, the more you learn, the more you understand how you didn't get the point. You know how deep it is? You probably don't have an idea what I'm talking about. The rabbi, he understands what I'm talking about. But I'm telling you, without Chas v'Shalom putting anyone down, I'm including myself, the more you learn the Gemara, the more you realize how complicated and deep it is. Learning first time, after you learn who against who and the words and how it works, now you begin to imagine that you understand. That's really a very common symptom. So what happened is, now it makes a lot of sense to you. Oh, that's the opinion, that's the other opinion. Why he say left and he say right, and they both bring a proof. How would I know who's right? And then this whole thing is beautiful. But then after years that you already more experienced and you learn it again one day, it looks like two different things completely. You begin to understand the small details, how it all falls. Then you begin to, you say to yourself, how people wrote such thing? How? until today, one of my biggest thing that I'm impressed so much from is on Rav Ashi and Ravina, how they wrote the Talmud. No internet, no computers. Two people have to sit and write thousands of pages. Each two, three lines is a very deep sugya. It's a complicated thing. They go from one topic to another, and they put everything together to edit such a thing, to put it together. It's thousands of pages, thousands of topics, hundreds of thousands of different opinions of rabbis who lived in a period of 400 years with no connection, no telephone, no printing like today, not even a pen. They put everything together in such a brilliant way. I tell you the truth, I'm more impressed from the Talmud than the actual Torah that Hashem wrote. Because when Hashem writes, no, Hashem can do whatever he wants. He's divine, he's perfect. When I look at the Talmud, I'm more impressed than the Talmud, a million times more than the Torah. Because this is people that had a heart and brain and fingers like us and a mouth. They talk the language we speak, Hebrew. And they wrote this Talmud, the two people, everything without contradiction. How did they know? How could they remember such a massive amount of information? Because remember, if they will make mistakes, like all the other 80,000 fake religions and cults, every page you have mistakes. Why? As brilliant as they may be, how much a person can remember? I always say the Goyim, they made a critical mistake, but they had a catch-22. It was a no-win situation. Why? Because you want to fake a religion, you want to start a fake religion. Now, if you come and say, up to now, the Jews, for 1,300 years, they have all over the world, everyone knows Jews are the important people. God spoke to them. They had the temple. People saw miracles in the temple. Cannot deny it. So to come and say, Judaism until now was all an illusion. It really never happened. God never gave the Jews the Torah in Mount Sinai. All these things that the Jews do, I don't know where they come from. No one will take you serious, man. It's like me trying to deny that the twins collapsed in Manhattan. Oh, there was nothing like this. The Twin Towers. What do you mean? The whole world saw it live. No, it really never happened. It was just an illusion. Someone made up the story. Anyone would take me serious? No one would take me serious. So now I have a problem. As much as I hate it, I have to confirm that what happened to the Jews happened. Why? Because no one would take me serious. It's reality. So let's do something tricky. Let's say that the same God who gave the Torah and Judaism to the Jews got tired of them and made a turn, and now the world is shifting to a different side. You're supposed to go that way. The Jews missed the opportunity that they got, and many opportunities, like the Muslims try to claim, and now it's a different world. So because this is the claim, I have to continue from where Judaism ended. Okay, so where the Tanakh ended, the 24 Songs of Songs, the prophet time is ending, the Tanakh is finished. Let's start the New Testament, part two. But where the problem is, because remember, first of all, in order for you to continue after 24 books were written, you know how much information you have to know? How much information you have to remember? You know how many tens of thousands of names, genealogies, dates, geography, so many things to remember. Look at the size of the Tanakh. Look at the Tanakh. Millions of words. You don't have a computer that you do search like today. You Google something and it comes. It all has to be in your head 100%. So it's enough that you have 5% lack of knowledge, it will mess up your book. There's no way to do it. Whoever did it was very foolish. To try to continue from where 24 books ended and continue without contradicting the past, impossible. It's impossible. That's why we're lucky that all these fake religions who came after, they all look like monkeys compared to us. Why? Because it's full of mistakes. I know you see mistakes. Not just mistakes, foolish mistakes. That's the more foolish the mistake is, the easier it is to detect that it's fake. So, I started to explain Avraham Avinu. Avraham Avinu is praying that Hashem will save the five cities of the wicked people. And this is his calculation. He say, maybe there are 10 righteous people in every place. There's a kosher minyan that will save the entire city. That's based on the words of the Zohar. The Zohar say that everyone think when the entire nation of Israel will be righteous, the Messiah will come. So first of all, it's not true, because the Zohar say even one knishta, one shul, one kosher shul, that people don't speak over there. And it's 100% for the sake of heaven. The rabbi is kosher. The people are kosher. There's modesty. Men separate. Women separate. Nobody talks. Everyone comes to pray. Everyone comes to sing to Hashem, to do the right thing. And it's been going on for years. Even one place, one community can have enough merit to bring the Messiah. What's with the rest of the nation? They don't have the merit. But one knishta chada, united together with no racism, no hatred, none of these things that we see everywhere we go, no politics, no fightings, no honor requesting, all these things that we see everywhere we go, clean the place from all the politics and make it 100% pure, it's enough. So I started to say, so when a person goes to a place, it's not so simple. We're going away for Shabbos. What do you mean you're going away for Shabbos? Do you understand the impact that it's going to have on your children? Do you know what it means? You have a place, supposedly you did everything you can to live in a kosher place. Now you're going away on vacation. This whole vacation thing is very annoying, because if you don't take the children, you have to worry who you're leaving them with. Just to put a babysitter to watch your children for a week, do you know what she's going to feed them? Do you know what she's going to do to keep them quiet? Do you know what she's going to show them? Do you know what she's going to talk to them? Well, you build up 10 years of education to make your children holy. In 1 week, she'll destroy everything, she or he, whatever. So that's already a big risk. There's a very very heavy price for the vacation. He tried to save $500 on the airfare and another $200-$300 in the hotel, and he's so happy. Oh, I saved $800, I got the coupon, I got this. In the end, the education that you're going to have to now fix with your children will cost you millions. Maybe you're going to have to come back to the whole world for 70 more years of suffering for destroying your children by putting them in the wrong hands. Now, let's say you take your children with you. Do you know one place in the world that is kosher for vacation? Please tell me the name. One place. Show me one place in the world that is kosher for a religious Jew to go for vacation. No, I want to hear. I didn't find that place yet. Florida, none of the places there are kosher. LA, nothing is kosher. Israel, nothing is kosher, unless if you go to yeshiva, you go to Mea Shearim, but that's not a vacation. Oh, that's a spiritual trip. You're going to, from one yeshiva to another yeshiva, you're going to learn, you take your children into a very religious community for Shabbatot, for a week, and that's no problem. Well, you know, we're not talking about this kind of vacations here. So what? You go to Eilat, not kosher. Tiberias, not kosher. Puerto Rico, not kosher. Cancun, not kosher. No? The kids will ask you, hey, Abba, why all the ladies are naked here? What are you going to say? So, well, they're not Jewish. Let's say you say, they're not Jewish, they're not modest. So he's going to say to you, if he's clever, so why we came here? We have permission to come here? Lot, the Torah speaks about Lot in a positive way. When Lot all of a sudden became Hitler in 1 minute, when he decided to move to Manhattan, that's it, or to San Francisco. The moment he decided to move to Sodom and Gomorrah, you from the family of Avraham Avinu, your uncle is the chief rabbi of the world, you want to move to the village? What happened before he even moved? Right away, the Torah, the Talmud, put an X on him. And why did he want to move there? Business. Rabbi, we have to make a living. We have 2 houses, 15 cars, these pension plans, that, children. We have to buy each one of our son a house, this. We have plans. So we need $8-9 million. If we're not going to go every day and work, how are we going to make the money? Right? That's how people justify it. So here comes another question. Who say that wealth overcome eternity? Religion is eternity. You either earn it or you lose it. That's it. There's no in between. You either get the ticket that we're all anxious to get, or you lost the ticket. Now, what person would agree to have 30 years of wealth and physical pleasure and lose eternity of spirituality, of the greatness of God? Only another fool, a total fool, would still not agree. No one agrees. So why people do it, almost everyone, with yarmulke, without yarmulke? Why everyone almost choosing the comfortable life here on the expense on the afterlife? The Gemara says, Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa, he was a very poor rabbi. Very poor. So poor, doesn't know what to eat. Do you know any poor person doesn't have a piece of bread to eat? All the poor people in the world, if they want bread, they get bread. Every homeless on the street, if he come to a baker and say, give me two slices of rye bread, I'm dying, I promise you, they're going to give him, and every day they're going to give him. For years. They won't let him starve. He doesn't ask for money, for drugs. He wants two slices of rye bread to survive. How much it costs? 10 cents? Not even. They'll give him. I'm sure they will. So the poor people have what to eat, but the Gemara described Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa was eating carobs. What carobs? It's like pieces of sticks. They have a little sweetness in them, but they have seeds inside. Today they're full of worms. It's impossible to eat it. But in the old days, the vegetables and fruits didn't have so much worms like today. So you eat carobs. What kind of stomach he had that he can eat these carobs? It cuts the stomach. And he drinks water. That's what he does. That's how poor he is. He cannot afford oil for the candles of Shabbat. Oil. Well, how much oil costs to put a little oil for the candle? They cannot afford. That's how poor he was. And the Torah says that God announced the whole world receive his wealth thanks to this righteous man. The whole world. Everything I give to the world is thanks to the merit of this man. But he is comfortable eating carobs from Friday to Friday. Means in Shabbat he was eating maybe a little bit better. But that's it, that's Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa. One time, while he got wealth, his wife was complaining that how many years they're going to suffer. And then they showed him in a dream that he had a table with three legs of gold, and now one leg broke. So he said to her, you see, the wealth that we got now took away from our afterlife. So he prayed that Hashem will take away the wealth. So the Gemara say, taking the wealth back was a bigger miracle than giving him the wealth. Because usually when something good comes, if you receive a gift, Hashem doesn't take the gift away from you. If he gave it to you, he gave it to you. That's yours. All the warnings in the Torah are conditional. Doesn't have to happen. A person may tshuva, repentance, so the threat or the punishment that he's supposed to get, we won't get, because he corrected his evil way. But something good, or even a good promise, even if you got a promise, even between now until you're supposed to receive the good, you became wicked, you still get the good. Why? Hashem promised good, you get good. That's the rule. Something bad, it's conditional. Even a minute before you made repentance, Hashem canceled the decree. Something good is already yours. You earned it. So, we live, we do certain things, and after all that, you know, we let the life choose for us what to do. And that's the big mistake. Remember, we cannot let life detect for us where to go, what to do. We have to control our destiny. We have to control our future. Of course, there are certain things is not in our hand. Not everything is in our hand. If you have children or not, it's not in your hand. You try. If Hashem doesn't want, you won't have. You try to make wealth. You try. If Hashem doesn't want, you won't have. I'm not talking about things that are not in our hands. I'm talking the things that are in our hands. What kind of job to choose? What kind of place where to live? What kind of places to go? Where to go to vacation? To go to places that it's not kosher, or to find a place that over here it's safe. All these things that we do, this is in our hands. Plus, there's one more thing. Today, there's another sickness in our life that science controlling religion. Well, that's a very big problem. Religion should be the highest authority. That's how it's been always, even by the Christians. The church was the top authority. There's no secular court that tells the priest what to do. In every place, the priest in every town used to be the boss, the chief. Even the king were afraid of the priest. The church was always above everything else. Needless to say, the rabbis, they are way before church even started. There was the top authority. The rabbi is the chief, the boss, the king of the place. It was always like that. Plus, religion decide what's allowed, what's not allowed. So that's the other way around. First, everything is invented, iPhones, these, all kinds of devices. Now we have to see how religion permits it or not and how we can go around. The science cannot dictate for us. For instance, now they already invented all kinds of ways to determine the sex of the baby. It's going to be a boy or a girl. They have already a way to do it now. Do you know what it's going to do to the world if you're going to make it legal? In India, for instance, nobody wants women. Only men they want. If the wife gives birth to a woman, it's a life risk for her. She can get killed. Yeah, if they have a girl over there in India, the Indians don't like women. I don't know why. They only want boys. So what would happen now? According to the Torah, a boy does a greater service to his father after the father dies than a girl. Not that a boy is more important than a girl, but the boy is obligated to learn Torah if he's learning Torah. So if a father died and he left a boy and a girl, how many mitzvot the girl will do for the father? Hardly anything. How many mitzvot the woman keeps in a day? She walks modest, it's very important. She eats kosher, she makes few brachot, she reads a little bit Tehillim, she keeps once a week Shabbat. You know, fine, that's it, that's just about it. She keeps Nida once a month. No, you add it up, 3,000 mitzvot a year. Raising the kids. But the boys, they go to yeshiva, come back at night, 10 hours he learns, 600,000 mitzvot every day. And he says it's for the merit of the soul of my father. So it helps the father a lot. So the bra mezake av, the Gemara says. Bra means a boy. Mezake means merit. Av, the father. Right? So if you ask the religious people, every religious person would say, give me 5, 6 boys, 1 girl. If science, if it will become legal, now they're still clever, not to make it legal. They only will give it to families who have 4 girls and they want 1 more baby, so they allow them to have 1 boy. Or you have 4 boys, you want 1 girl, so they allow it. Or certain things like this. It has to be under supervision. But you know how life is. Once it exists, all you need is a foolish president one day to come, or a foolish Congress. No, freedom of choice. You're not going to tell us what to do. Everyone has the right to choose what he wants. The next thing, in the next generation, you have 90% men, 10% women. What will happen in the world? The whole world will be in a danger. So this is an example of a scientific advance that can destroy the world. Let me give you another example. Today, we eat a lot of seeds. Corn, wheat, barley. None of it is what it used to be 30, 40 years ago. All this genetic interference with nature, first of all, put the entire world in danger because they can create an epidemic that billions of people will die or people will become monsters. They can, you know, this is very dangerous. I spoke to a scientist from a university who came to speak in Englewood, and they are one of the pioneers in the world. They were invited by Walmart because Walmart owned trillions of dollars of things like this, and they come to give them advice what to do, what not to do. But you should know that they interfere with the seeds, it can destroy the world. It's worse than a biological weapon. That's how dangerous it is. And now I read an article that many people that eat bread, they suffer. They have sicknesses. I think it's called celiac. There's a name for this sickness. Nobody had it, say, 70, 80 years ago because it used to be pure grains, pure barley, pure wheat, that's it. Now, with all the interference that they do, many people become sick. They get allergic, all kinds of things, allergic to this, allergic to that. All these kind of allergies, basically, they're growing much more than before. plus cancer. Why 100 years ago nobody had cancer? Why today almost every other person has cancer? Is this coincidence? Spiritually, you can explain that people are walking naked on the street and makes God very angry. People are not modest. People make a lot of sex crimes. People do a lot of things that people did not dare to do 100 years ago. So we're paying the price for our sins. That's in a spiritual way. In a physical, normal way, what's the explanation? It's what we eat, is the cell phones, is computer, is radiation, is electric, all the wires has an effect on our life. Look, you walk, you speak on the phone, if there's wires, it's affecting the things. There's something in the air that electric does, or the radio. Even the radio cannot catch when you're going to under wires. Being under these wires for a while, it can affect so many systems of our body. There's one street in Muncie, 6 people in that block got cancer. Why? There's a cellular phone antenna right there. By some kind of a company, they have a big antenna over there. Now people realize it's not coincidence. Almost every house there got it. So we see certain things that are happening right now that science helping you in one way and destroying you in another way. I'll give you another example. Medicine. All the chemicals that the company sell, medicine, right? Medicine is something good or something bad. When you take an Advil today, it takes away the headache, almost guarantee. You have headache, you took 1 or 2 Advils, the headache is gone. Do you know how many sicknesses are growing in your body because of that now? You don't know. The company will not tell you the truth. Somebody who knows about medicine told me almost every medicine who cure one problem create 10 others. It's designed to do like this. That's why the medicine companies are the richest in the world. That's why they decide who's going to be the president of the United States. They control everything here. The medicine company, they tell the president what to do. You want to be the president, you want billions of dollars from us, you want us, you have to pass this rule, you have to pass. This is what's happening here. All these chemicals, who say it's good? Birth control, 30, 40 years that women started to take it. Maybe that's the reason why 1 out of 8 women has breast cancer. Do you know? What are the doctors know about medicine? The doctors do not even know 1% of the necessary knowledge in medicine. Of the body. What do they know? They know it helps you hear how many other sicknesses. Who would know? Only God knows. No one can know. Not the rabbis, not the priests, not the doctors, not the scientists. Nobody knows about the brilliance of the human body. 900 years ago, we had the Rambam. 2,000 years ago, we had Chazal. We saw Chazal had divine knowledge about our body. You see in the Gemara, like they used to make a paste and put it in the back of the head. You go to sleep. In the morning, you're able to see again. You went to sleep, you couldn't read, you couldn't see. In the morning, you got up and you see. With making a natural paste and put it in the back of the head, you go to sleep, you wake up in the morning, you open up your eyes, you see beautiful. 2020. Who knows these things today? The knowledge that King David had about medicine, King David, no doctors in the world has today. He was able to remove the spleen from his soldiers that when they go to the war, they can run for days without getting tired. No doctors in the world knows how to make this operation today. There are many things they used to do, nobody knows today how to do. Nobody knows. Even the Greeks were better doctors than today. Not to say that today medicine doesn't have a lot of nice things. They have surgeries, they're removing things. There's the modern medicine also have a lot of positive things. I'm not saying no. But overall, all this chemical medicine that we take, destroying humanity today. Plus, there's another problem. When finally somebody invents a medicine that can save billions of people from dying in the next 100 years, if it's against the medicine that they sell, they won't let this medicine come out. They take this person and they buy it from him and they destroy the cure. They're not interested that the cure will go out because they sell, for instance, for heart attacks or for cholesterol. You know how many trillions of dollars they make? By selling all these, every doctor gives you, a little bit higher cholesterol, yalla, start going on this pill. They sell it to you, $100 every person per month, all these pills, multiplied by billions of people. It's very big business. Now imagine somebody invented a medicine, you eat it, that's it, you'll never have cholesterol. It controls the cholesterol for the rest of your life. They'll never let it go out. It'll take away all their profit. They'll buy it from him. They give him $20 million and they buy it from him and destroy it. And it happens all the time. And if he refused to sell, he wouldn't want to take the money, they'll kill him. Read. There's a lot of books about these things. I didn't invent it. You won't be able to. If someone will invent cure for cancer now, they'll never let it happen. You know how much money they make from this? These chemo doctors, it's very big business. And many other things in life. That's why we live in such a world. You take a medicine, you don't even know what you put in your mouth. That's why so many religious parents refuse to take medicine, and they also refuse to take vaccines. Also, vaccines is dangerous. Vaccine, what is vaccine? It's they take from the disease that you had, they make it weaker, and they inject it into the body to fight against it. But some of these vaccines killed people in the past. Vaccine is not so simple that it's good. That's why some parents refuse to take vaccines. The body is designed to fight everything. Also, I'll give you another example. I read a good book from a woman that she's a doctor, a very religious woman, Orthodox, that she's about 30 or 40 years a doctor of children. If you read this book, you'll be amazed from how foolish we are when it comes to our health. She says, this is what I used to do according to what I learned in school, and this is what I do according to the Torah. And I found out the differences. For instance, a person has fever. The body raised the temperature by 1 or 2 degrees. There's a reason why the body make the, why the when there's a sickness, you feel fever. This extra 2 degrees making some changes and adjustments in your body. But it takes, instead of, you have to be in bed for about 3-4 days. And also you lose your appetite. This reason, she explains everything. Why you lose your appetite, why you're weak. What Hashem wants right now, how to cure you, he sets a way that the body cure itself. But what today we do? We don't want to lose 3 days in business. Right away, you take medication. After a day, you feel good. But she said, like later, in the long run, it creates tons of problems to the health. And she brings proofs, scientific proofs, what it does to the body. So this is just to show you how in the darkness we are. How in the darkness we are. Let's go back to what we started. So Avraham Avinu, one person against billions, against millions, and he's trying to defend 5 cities from destruction by claiming there's 10 righteous people, for them you leave the entire place. And Hashem said, if there will be 10 righteous people in this city, I will not destroy the city. So what do we learn from this? First, Hashem said, Avraham is my servant. He's a faithful servant, he's a righteous man. I'm about to destroy millions of peoples. I should consult with him first. The creator of the world wants to consult with a person named Avraham. Does it make sense to you? The creator of the world, he sees everything. There's one righteous man. Very nice, you're righteous. Good for you. You'll get what you deserve. No. I'm going to do something without telling Avraham first. So what do you see from here? It pays to be righteous. That's why the Gemara said, the righteous person say, Hashem is taking it seriously to consideration. Tzadik goes there, he makes a decree. The students of Rabbi Zion Abba Shaul, they testified hundreds of times in his life. He said something that nobody believed. How can it be? And exactly how he said it happened, against all odds. Why? The righteous person say, "Atzadik gozer, Hashem Baruch Hu Mekayem." So, Avraham Avinu, we learn from this story one more thing, that if you live in a city with lots of wicked people, if overall there's one kosher yeshiva over there, and there's righteous people there that learns Torah, and it's not enough only to learn Torah. You have to be a good, decent human being. Not to steal, not to cheat, not to lie, not to curse, not many other things. To be Baal Chesed, kind, and all these things that the Torah requires. Plus learning Torah, plus holiness, plus all the other things that you're required to do by law. So that's you are in a category of a righteous person. So if there are 10 righteous people and 200 million wicked people in that place, the 10 righteous people will save the entire place. And what are the other people do in return to say thank you to the 10 people who they are, their insurance policy curse them nonstop, write about them in the media, fight with them, kick them from the neighborhood. Go to Israel, see what happened. This is the biggest crime in history. You live thanks to them, you eat thanks to them, you breathe thanks to them, the missile of Ahmadinejad didn't fall on your head thanks to them, and all you do is cursing them on the media, writing against them in a newspaper, fighting with them on the street, and non-stop complaining how you have to give money to their yeshivot. Does it make sense to you? Does it make sense to you? Imagine now a person has a problem, some mafia guy wants to kill him. And the mafia guy is ambushing his house every week. And he got a real Rambo fighter to protect him. And this soldier doesn't sleep day and night protecting him. They come, he attack them. He protect him for weeks. Every week he's staying alive thanks to this hero. What happened in the end? He kills him, he spits at him, he starves him. Stay outside, don't come inside. What would you say about a person like this? He deserves to stay around. This is what's happening. The Torah says, that's what happens when you don't have Torah education. Every second of your life is a mistake. The Torah says, thanks to the Torah, the world exists. What does the world do? Hates the Torah. The Goyim, why the Goyim came to destroy Beit HaMikdash? Why the Babylonians care that so far in Israel, there is in Jerusalem a synagogue on the mountain that the Jews do their service over there. What did Babylon, what Nebuchadnezzar care? Can't leave. Oh, the Jews practicing their religion, we have to destroy it. So they come, they destroy the temple. The Greeks, what the Greeks care about what the Jews do in Israel? Stay in your place, enjoy your place. You want the Jews to pay you taxes? You occupy Israel? You set up the amount of taxes? They'll pay you the tax. Leave them alone. What do you care, freedom of religion? Let them do whatever they want. Why does it bother you? What do you want? You want slaves? You want servants? You want money? You want control? You can have it without destroying the temple. No, I can't sleep at night. The Jews practicing their religion have to destroy the temple. Then the Romans. Why? They are in Italy now. Why they have to come to Jerusalem to destroy the temple? Why all the other empires, first thing they wanted is to come to Israel and fight against this tiny nation? What's happening here? So the Gemara said the Goyim destroyed the temple that was protecting them and actually shooting themselves in the leg. Because every Sukkot they used to sacrifice 70 cows, one for each nation. There were 70 main nations. Like the Arabs have 20 countries, 20 nations, but it's really one, Ishmael. So 20 is falling into one. And in Russia there's so many things, they're all the same. They just broke it to different, Georgia, this, Lithuania, all this. It's all Russians. Yeah, you tell them they don't like to hear it. You know, but they all come from the same area. So 70 nations all together, if there are in the world. Even though today can be hundreds or thousands, whatever it is, doesn't matter. There are 70 roots. And they used to sacrifice one for each nation. And that used to protect them from a lot of problems. To the Goyim, it was a sacrifice for their sins, for the entire thing, for the entire country. And now they come, they destroy the altar. There's no way to sacrifice. So who get hurt? They get hurt. That's besides the punishment that Hashem will give them for hurting the Jews. I say to one Arab person, I said to him, do you believe in the Torah? He said, yes. You know that God gave the Torah? Of course. What's the question? So did you ever read the Torah? Of course. Don't you read in the Torah that God loved the Jews? Why are you making so much problems for the Jews? If you really love God, you should help the Jews. You should support them. Why? If you're the son of the king of the world and he called you my son in the Torah, if I'm a smart goy, first thing I want to do is to serve you as much as I can. If I met a person, he tell me, you know, I'm the son of the president. Nobody knows. I'm Obama's son. Yeah, I'm a hidden son. Only me and my father, you know, I go to him, we meet, we sit, we learn together. But I don't want to be, you know, famous. And show me, Chris Obama. And I said, wow, it's a great opportunity. I'll be the friend of the son of Obama, no? What would I do now? Try to go against him? Try to make him problems? Or try to be good friends with him that his father would like me? I want his father to like me. Maybe he cut away the killer taxes that I'm paying on my house. Maybe he will dismiss me from other problems that I have. No, he can do whatever he wants. Maybe he can give my relatives an American passport. All kinds of things that people think. Maybe I need. Maybe he'll save me from this. Maybe it's good connection with the king. No. So if I met the prince and the king loved him so much, according to the Torah, why would I want to be an anti-Semite? This is something that I don't know. You see that I can't control it. Just can't control it. Because logically, it was the great investment. If I was a goy, first thing I would want to do, maybe I also wouldn't be able to control it. It's like telling the cat, leave the mouse alone. It's hard, you know. But technically, if I was a goy, first thing I would like to do, and I know some goyim like this. That means it's possible that they love the Jews because God loved them. There's millions like this in the world. There are goyim who donate CDs for the Jews to be religious that makes Hashem happy, to save the children of Hashem. So what do you see? There are clever goyim out there. Not everyone automatically hate the Jews, hate Torah, hate this. No. I'm just saying there's two sides here. But if I was a goy, there would be the greatest opportunity for me to meet 2, 3, 4 Jews and try to help them as much as I can. Because knowing God loved this person so much, he called him my son. We have one son of God. 2 billion of us worshiping him, even though he's dead already a long time ago. Now is an opportunity to help a live son of God, not someone who died already 2,000 years ago, if he ever lived, Bichlal. Now there is a live one right next to me. I have an opportunity to be with him, to help him, to do things. What? I don't really help him. I help myself for egoistic reasons. Because if I help the son of the king, who do I really help? I help me and my children. Tomorrow when I have a problem, who is going to help me? The king. Why is he going to help me? I help his children. He's going to help me. That's why I always tell people who don't have children. They try. They do. I say, oh, I have a great solution for your problem. Not that it's in my hand. It's not in my hand. But what's the solution? Show God that you care about his children. He'll give you children. Measure for measure. Everything in the Torah is measure, for good and for bad. You don't have children, or you have bad children, you want them to be good. What's the best way to turn them good? You come to the king, to the kids of the king. You help them to be good. He's going to make your children good, like this. You don't have children, you help his children, he'll give you also your children. He enjoys from his children thanks to your money. He'll give you children that you enjoy. You make his children religious. They keep Shabbat. They do good things for him. He's going to be happy. Why wouldn't he give you children that you'll be happy from them? Make sense or no? That's it. Measure for measure. And it worked. Many times people did it and it worked for them. 100%. Also, it's a great sgula to get married. Throughout the years, every single guy who came to help me to organize lecture right away got engaged. If it's good or not, I'm not sure. Not that it's not good to get married. Every person needs to get married. But I'm saying if it's good or not that it happened, I'm not sure. I tell you why. Because this person starts to organize lecture. People come. They become religious. And then they bring other people. And it's a chain reaction. So they get the schut, the merit, for doing all this activity. Now, as soon as they get engaged, what's the first thing the girls say? Listen, I don't want a guy that every night is out there. I want to get a husband. So right away he quit. So he gets his wife and he quit. So the question is, what's good? To get a wife and quit or to continue to do kiruv and not to get a wife for another 2, 3 years? I leave it for your intelligence to understand what's better or not. But one thing, the Satan say, you know what? This guy does so much for the Jewish nation by bringing so many people to the lectures. Let me give him a wife. Like they say, shut him up. Take your wife right away. You're busy. Marriage, preparation, $10,000 wedding gown, this, that. Right? It happened to me all the time. I've seen these people. They do some activity. soon as the thing's starting to grow, oh, Baruch Hashem, you are invited to my engagement party. Soon as they say that to me, I say, here, another soldier is gone. And then another one. So that's a very good segula to get married. If anyone doesn't have a wife, cannot find a wife, come organize 2 months. Two, maximum 3 months. You see, mamash, a miracle. How you all you get engaged. Why? That's why, remember the rule. The Satan, when he see he cannot surrender a person in his way, he will give him gifts to attract him to a negative side. For instance, if a person he wants to keep Shabbat, he's already, you understand, ma. So the Satan doesn't want him to keep Shabbat, but how is he going to make him not Shomer Shabbat? He's going to tell him not to be Shomer Shabbat. You want to understand, it's the most important thing. So he will attract him slowly, slowly, by giving him all kinds of other mitzvot to do. Go here, go there, or slow. Oh, go over there, you have a great opportunity to do mitzvah. Go over there, go over there, up until he pulls him out. It's not right away like this. When a person kills his friend, what do you think? It's a 5-minute incident? No. In the beginning, he makes a comment and another comment. It's like 1 year, 2 years, he accumulate all the comments. And then he does this, and the Satan arranges it. Fop, until the punchline. It's not right away, he says something and you take a gun and kill him. Even though today it happens also. But it's something who build up. And Satan is building it in a very clever way. Same thing over here. If the Satan see you about to do a huge mitzvah, right away he offers you a mitzvah that you're going to get a lot less for it. To offer you to make a sin, in this moment he cannot, because he knows he won't help. So what does he do? Attracts you to something that is not important. You finally decided to write $10,000 check to donation. He cannot prevent it. That's it. You made a lot of money. You want to thank God. So right away, you say, okay, I'm giving now $10,000 donation. God was so nice to me, kind to me. Let me be grateful. I don't want to be ungrateful. So you're about to write it. So you're about to give it to a holy cause. Right away, the Satan sends you some crook. Right away, again, we have this organization, this, that. Takes your money, go to Atlantic City, lose the money over there. A day later, the hurricane comes, wipe out the hotel with the money, and that's what happened. That's what happened. One time I was in my own eyes, I saw a person raising funds. And in the middle, one person was there, say, the guy next to him, say, you know what? I'm embarrassed to admit that I myself was in Atlantic City on Shabbat, but I'm telling you, I've seen this guy in Atlantic City gambling. So, pretend he's religious. They come, they clear. In my own eyes, I saw him in the casino. So I just, why are you doing the casino on Shabbat? Not on Shabbat. He said, listen, I couldn't hold myself. I'm making myself look bad, but I have to say it because everyone is about to give this crook money. Let's conclude with this. After all the negotiation, there was not enough people to save them, and Hashem wiped them out. If we check the 5,800 years almost that we hear in this world, it's not the first time Hashem did this to the world. I mean, yes, that was a disaster, but then there was the flood. There was other incidents, the Holocaust, just we remember from two generations ago. There are massive tragedies in the world, massive tragedies. To think, to live in an illusion that everything will be fine, it's a big mistake. Person has to be alert to see what's happening in the world. People are asking now it's the time to go to Israel after this hurricane? You see that God is very angry at the United States. One disaster after the other. Every week something happening here. Economy, problem, now with Iran, who knows what's going to be next. So now my question to you is, God is very angry at the United States, but anybody can come and raise his hand and say that the situation in Israel is any better? Show me one aspect that is better in Israel. The economy here is bad. It's true that the economy in Israel is not as bad, but is on the way to be just as bad. It's already collapsing now. Give it another 6 months, then you see what's going to happen. It's already collapsing. The situation in Israel is not, that's it, it's on the way down. Security-wise, where it's safer to live? Yeah, we have natural disasters, it's true. But in Israel, No, there's not one day without the rockets. They shoot rockets everywhere. You live in fear, constant fear all the time. As far as the future, what's the future here? Maybe this country will go bankrupt, default on what they owe China and the rest of the world. And the dollar will not be the world currency, the world reserve currency, which means the dollar will collapse to zero. What happened now in Iran? One coin became 35,000. $1, 35,000 Iranian toman, I think that's the name of it. 35,000 for $1. You know what? the Iranian money has no value, nothing. You see it on the street, that's worth to bend down to pick it up because of the situation with the sanction. It can happen tomorrow here in America. It happened in Argentina. It happened in Ireland. It happened in other countries. It can happen in the United States. And what do you think would happen in a day that it happens? Nobody would be able to walk on the street. You won't be able to put a watch on your head. You won't be able to wear a nice suit. You will have to pretend that you're homeless, wear clothes, make holes in your clothes, walk in the street like you're homeless. Because everyone will have something valuable right away. Someone will grab it with a gun and take it away from you. People would fight for survival. Nobody would care to die or to go to jail. Jail won't be a threat. Jail will be an hotel. At least in jail, the government maybe still have to feed you, unless they close the jails and they release everyone. But people want to, well, where are you gonna, what are you going to do if your money, all the millions you save becomes dust? Then there's no value to anything anymore. That's why people buy gold. Why do you think gold keeps going high, high, high? Gold, diamonds, and all the groceries are constantly, things that has value, the prices constantly go up. Everything else, there's no value. It's all collapsing. The money is not really nothing. An American dollar, it's really a check from the government. That's what it is. It's a check from the government. So what is it like? I have a $100 check. So I give it to him. He takes my check. He goes to the grocery. They see. They give him $100. The grocery passes it to his supplier. Supplier to his supplier. He gives it to his landlord. It's the same check, but the check doesn't really have a value. It's a piece of paper. They're just constantly buying you things because of the word of the government that they will one day respect the check, which is the American dollar. But if the government collapses, that means people will kill each other every second here like crazy. Now, what do you think? In Israel, the situation is better? You know what would happen if there's going to be a war or they attack Iran? Now real estate is going higher, 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 like a balloon, like it happened here. As soon as you hear that they tried to attack Iran, whether they succeed, whether they didn't succeed, it won't make a difference. So right away oil from 80 or 90 will go right away to $200 in a minute, right away. Which means, now you saw what happened now in the last days, people standing on lines here for 4 hours to get gas. You won't even be able to get gas. Only 10% of the population could afford to pay gas. Who would be able to pay $10 a gallon? You want to drive from Muncie to Queens, it will cost you $100 gas. The whole day you don't make $100 if you walk. It's already now absurd what's happening here. Person wants to drive with his car with gas and tolls to get to work. By the time he gets the gas and the tolls and the lunch that he has to pay, that's what he makes. After taxes, that's it. He works for free. Average, typical Americans, smart people, college degree, $30,000 a year. Transportation already alone would cost them half of it with food just to survive. What's going on here? So I said, the government prints money as much as they want, but one day the world will decide we don't want the dollar to be the reserve. That's it. They won't be able to print. The dollar won't have a value. That will be a disaster. So there's so many threats. So if they attack in Iran, you know what would happen in Israel? Oh, the Hezbollah will shoot 10,000 missiles in a minute. And the Hamas and all the tunnels that we don't even know what they prepared for us in the last 20 years. The Arabs do not rest one second. They have one dream, to destroy us. They don't stop a second. And the whole world is a massive network of terrorism that move billions of dollars by weapons, sending all the Libyan weapons arrive to Gaza. They have already rockets now that can shot missiles, F-16s. They came from Gaddafi. the Russians sell, the Russians support Syria, Iran support all the terrorism. This is massive amount, millions of people who deal with terrorism, and they have all the money in the world. And we are a tiny nation who already lived by a miracle 60, 70 years. It's the biggest miracle in history how Israel survived among all these wolves. I have said it a few years ago. All they have to do is to walk. No, they don't have to fight. Why do they? All they have to decide. Tomorrow we all walk to Israel. That's it. 1.5 billion Muslims will walk. What are you going to do? Nothing you can do. What, are you going to start killing them? You kill one Palestinian, the whole world is on you. When are you going to start shooting thousands of people who walk to the border with no weapon? There's nothing you're going to be able to do. So they try to defend Israel from all these liberal Turkish and Jews who came on a boat. You see what happened. Turkey became our enemy. Why? 8 people died. 8 people died. Billions of dollars, all the maneuvers, all the agreements with Turkey, security agreement, the Air Force that were allies, all the, they knew the codes of Israel. Israel knew their codes. They were supposed to defend each other. All preparation of 30 years. Relationship between two armies, two governments, trades, tourism. Everything in a minute is gone. They became our biggest enemy. Why? Because we didn't let this liberal faker come to give food to Gaza. Tell them, bring the food, we'll give them the food, no problem. No, they don't care about the food. They want to make problems. So the bottom line, what's the conclusion? We have nothing to do. What are you going to pretend? You're going to do? This somebody told me today, you know, I had a car before the hurricane now. So I'm thinking to myself, I'm going to park here. No, there are trees, he said. Okay, so it's not safe. So that, an hour until he found parking in a driveway somewhere, and he makes sure the only tree is near is 20 meters away, which is 60 feet away. He measured the height of the tree, that if the tree will fall, still won't reach my car. He goes inside the house, 30 minutes. Today, on the way here, my friend told me on the phone, Hashem picked up the tree with the roots, the size of the synagogue, this root. Picked it up in the air, it flew like this, smashed his car, $13,000 is gone, and he doesn't have insurance. After he went all over, over here there's no trees. Hashem said, you're trying to run away from me. He picked up the tree like this in the air, tree, huge tree, in the air. Like a piece of paper on his car and smashed it.
So where do you draw the line? What do you do?
You have to be righteous. That's all you can do. Righteous people also die, sometimes even young. But it doesn't matter. It's all what's going to come after. Everyone is afraid to die. I don't understand. What's this fear from dying? People have to be afraid what's going to happen after I die, not when I die. When I die, it's not so important whether I'm 60 or 80. What difference does it make? It's a blink of the eye anyway, life. People have to think, and the day that I die, where will I go? Where will I go? If I'm not Shomer Shabbos, I'm going to the worst place. If I'm a crook, I'm going to the worst place. If I'm not modest, I'm going to go to the worst place. This is what I have to be afraid of. Not from the Iranian threat and all this. Yeah, eventually, with or without them, we'll live. We'll move out of this world. The question is, where will I be in the time that it happened? Will I go to a good place? Or chas v'shalom, I go to a place that I'm going to have to start paying for 70 years of nonsense. That's it. That's what we have to worry about. You see, Avraham Avinu did the right thing. 3,000 years later, every person in the world knows him. Every person in the world learned about him. He's still a legend in the entire world. Same thing Jacob, same thing Moshe. Every Arab, Moshe, Musa, Moses, same thing. They learn about him every day. No one would learn about us. Why? Because we didn't do what they did. They did what they had to do. Everyone complains about his life, very hard life. Now with the hurricane, we didn't have power. It's freezing in the house, no hot water. You know that no computer, can't even check your bank account, no telephone. You have to run to someone that has a generator to charge your phone, like a beggar. What a favor, even to charge your phone for 20 minutes that you're gonna have, you will be able to use your cell phone. You feel like he did such favors to you. People were embarrassed on things that are ordinary. What was until 50 years ago? Nobody had electric. Nobody had the heat that we have today. People wanted to sit in the freezing weather. They have to bring trees, put fire in the house, smell the smoke, and still freezing. The entire house, you have to sit by the fire, not to freeze. No electric. That's how people live for thousands of years. How we lived in the last 6 days. Still people don't have power. That's how the whole world was. Rich, poor, doesn't matter. Everyone lived like this. You know, my neighbor come with a lamp. Like this, with the lamp. So it reminded me, like, how it used to be with the oil. Put oil in the lamp. That's how it was. Who took showers in the hot water? You stand like this, hot water, relaxing you. Yeah, you know what? How it would... An hour to prepare a shower. To get the trees, to put them under, to put fire. The wind doesn't put the fire off until the water warms. And to find a modest place that nobody comes and see. That's why people didn't take showers maybe once a week. In the time of the Gemara, they used to wash their face and hands and legs. No, nobody could afford the things that we have today. So the hands, even freezing water, it's not so big deal. The legs, the face, you can manage. The entire body, you suffer. So they only used to wash the three things, the face, the hands, and the legs. The rest of the body, Hashem Yirachem, how dirty it was. Today, a person didn't take a shower 2 hours extra is already feeling, wow, you know, I feel so bad. That's how it was. Hashem is taking us back in time now to show us how it used to be, to stop complaining. Right when the light comes back, everyone goes back to normal, everyone forgot. What's the message here? What's the message? Why in water? You know, when everything goes in water, it's like a mikveh, like the flood. Hashem could kill, in the time of the flood, 4,200, he can kill them in many different ways. Why he wanted to do a flood that is the whole world will cover with water? Because it's a mikveh. Water purifies the place. If you have a plate or something like that, how do you make it pure? You put it in a mikveh. Once it goes in the water and comes out, it becomes pure. Fire and water purify things. The Torah says certain things you have to pass it in fire. Certain things in water. And certain things you cannot purify, you have to break it. Cannot do anything. This is exactly what Hashem does. He's tired of what's happening here. Oh, Sodom and Gomorrah laws, not in my backyard. No. So people want to go against God. Another natural disaster, and another one, until Chas v'Shalom, the atomic bomb would fall here. What do you think? You can win against the laws of the creator of the world. He decided men with women, and you want to make it men with men, and you want to make it legal, and you want everything to pass normal, that he's going to close his eyes and agree with this? How foolish people can be. How? You have a desire, you have a sickness, and now you want to match the whole world to your sicknesses? And make your sickness normal and everyone else is sick. And supposedly the normal people who live according to the law of nature, endorsing that, they go down with them. That's what happened. So there are other reasons. There are other reasons why it happens. Only Hashem knows 100% why he did and what neighborhood got it and more and less and flood. And some places had flood, some places didn't have flood. Like by us, there was no floods. Why? Trees fell. But floods, there was no floods. You saw what happened in Seagate? Someone told me today almost every house there is destroyed. And in Brooklyn, and in other places, floods. Lots of floods. The tunnels, a lot of floods. Manhattan is tons of floods. And floods is very difficult to fix. It can sometimes can take 10 years to fix the damages. It makes everything rotten. It goes, the foundation of the houses, it makes all the highways underneath. Water goes under highways. Under highways, you have massive amount of sand. Right? You still don't see it right now. The water goes and goes and goes and goes. And eventually, you drive with a truck. The entire highway collapses. The truck can fall down. Why? There's no way to prevent water damages. The water always finds the wrong way to go into. We will see what's happened. Bezrat Hashem, all I'm saying is one thing. I have to worry about my life spiritually. Everything else is not in my hand. I'll be here, I won't be here. I have money, I won't have money. The world will be around, it won't be around. There will be New York. There won't be New York. I have to know one thing. When the time comes and Hashem does what he wants to do, I want to be one of these people that the Torah say, how are you going to get saved from the tragedies? Torah and kindness. I have Torah? Yes. I learned a lot of Torah? Yes. I didn't steal. I didn't cheat. I don't owe to anyone. No one is after me. I'm not playing tricks. I don't forge. I don't mislead people. I'm clean. I'm going to be modest. I do everything that's necessary to make Hashem happy. I watch what goes into my mouth. I watch what comes out of my mouth. I watch the way my wife dress, the way my children behave. I do everything I can. Shabbat is Shabbat. Respect is respect. I respect Hashem. I'm grateful to him. That's what a kosher person is. The rest. What are you worried about the rest? You have to do what you have to do. The rest is nothing to worry about. So, but the kids, like my wife sometimes tell me, but you're not worried about the kids? What to worry about the kids? The kids are the children of God, not our children. We are babysitters. It's a big mistake to think that these children is yours. We are only babysitters. Every person in the world is a son of God. He's a son of the creator of the world who made him and put him here in a test. He decided that Moshe will be your son and you'll babysit him until he'll be independent. He had to put him somewhere. Someone has to cook for him. So he put him by you. You're a babysitter. What do you think? You're doing anyone a favor here? No, but the children, I'm worried. Be safe. Be careful. Don't go there. This. What am I going to do alone with the children? What are you going to do alone? You raising really the children? You raising... Abraham threw Ishmael to the desert. Sarah, she was a prophet. She told him, listen, this is a wild beast. He's going to make our son go off the derech, go to a negative way. Get rid of him. When you have a rotten apple, you got to get rid of him. He has to get out of the basket. We lose one. What can we do to save the other? It was very hard for him. He loves him. He's his son, whatever, you know, after all. So Hashem said to him, listen to your wife. She knows better than you. And he gave him some water and some food to survive a day. Day, 2 days, whatever. And he put him in a desert. In 110 degrees, with Hagar, with his mother. And what happened? Technically, he was supposed to die. What happened? Hashem sent him an angel, saved him, turned him into a nation, gave them all the oil, 2 billion people, the whole world suffer from them. Everyone is afraid of them. They control every corner in the world. You understand? What happened? Who raised him? Who raised this wild beast? Hashem raised him. Hashem raised the wild beast. He won't raise the kosher little children with their parents, with other parents. Who raised us? Our parents think they raised us. If it was up to them, we would be destroyed a long time ago. How many parents know where their children are at 12 o'clock at night? How many children knows? Ask the kids here, their parents in Queens. Where is your son? I'm praying to Hashem that he's in a good place. But my heart tell me, Hashem Yirachem, where he is. Don't want to know. When they inside the house, where are they? They sit in the room now. Oh, where are your son? He's a good boy. Come from school, he's in the room. His body is in a room. Where is mine? There the film, Facebook, connection, this, all the horrible things on earth in front of his eyes. From morning, from evening to evening, to night. Where is your son? He's a good boy, Baruch Hashem. He's not on the streets. You have to be on the street to make sins. Give him free access to internet. Destroy his soul. And then you wonder how eventually he's going to turn into a monster. No, he's a good boy. You know, this is what's going on. So far, everything I say, you disagree, you agree. What do you think? You have any comments to make? Because time ran out. Anything I say you disagree with, don't hesitate. Tell me. Right or wrong? The situation is as I say or I'm exaggerating? What do you say? Ah, Moshe? I exaggerate or no? 100%? You agree? Yeah. Bezrat Hashem, hopefully, like I say, that each one of us will do the right, will make the right choices, that when whatever is supposed to happen will happen, will be among the people that the Torah and the prophet says that they will get saved in that horrible time that will come one day to the world in the time when the Mashiach come and the things will be prior to it. We want to be about the small group. There will be a small group that God would say, you scream my name and I picked you up and saved you. But not only saving me to live here, saving me for eternity. That's what's important. Baruch Adonai Le'olam. Amen v'amen.